Good day. This is Nanci Garnand with Remax Alliance, and today is July 29th, and it's Friday, so we are covering Foreclosure Friday and Investment Weekly. We'll take a look at a couple different scenarios as we start to feel comfortable with what's going on out there in the market. Now, what is interesting is this week there were only seven. As you might have noticed before, unless this is your first time to tune in, we used to get about 10 new bank-owned or foreclosure properties per week on the market. This week, we had seven. So, I'm not sure what to tell you that means at this point, because people are saying, and maybe it's because I'm looking at Larimer County, which you can see is on the west side of I-25, and Greeley was identified as one of the higher places for foreclosures, and maybe we should take a look at that sometime to see what's going on. Anyway, we have seven, so let's get started. And at the end of this, I'll show you one of the tools I use to analyze investments. And I never know what we're going to see. So I'm going to cover up my lovely face as we move forward here. And this first one is at $105,000. It's in Red Feather Lakes. It's a two-bedroom, one full bath. It's got two cabins on two lots. It's walking distance to Dowdy Lake. It looks like it needs probably a lot of work. Interesting setup. You want to get things covered so you don't ruin the insides here. And that's all the pictures we have. And let's see, it was on 0.18 of an acre. So, interesting place. Humboldt at Drive in Livermore's at 149. It's, looks like a modular with a walkout on it. Yep, I think that's what we've got here, folks. Red Feather Lakes, good condition, and this is a Fannie Mae property, so you can purchase it for as low as 3% down. Fort Collins, 600 10th Street, is at 159. It's a two-bedroom, one-bath home. It has a separate dining area, a daylight basement, and much more. And there's only six photos, so we can only go through those so many times. 3268 Thundering Herd Way in Wellington is 1,324 feet on the main floor and the same in the basement. It was built in 2003, and it looks like this one they've put in new carpet and paint. So it looked, and this one is another 3% down, and I love the way that they only have five or six photos in these places. Elgin Court in Fort Collins, 178.9. It looks like it's fairly open there. This one was built in 2003, and once again, all we're going to have is six photos to look at. Gold Hill Court. Now, this one interested me. I have shown this home in the past, and if you here's the kitchen, and when you get in the kitchen to see it, it's the European style that's very clean lines, very modern. And there's some interesting things about this house. And, of course, with only nine photos, I can't show it to you. You have an unfinished basement. And it's not quite southwestern in its appeal, and yet it could be that way from outside. It's in greenstone, so it's a great subdivision. Now, it's on the market for $299, and let me show you what the listing history was. It was on the market at one time at $375. They reduced it to $315, and then it was withdrawn. That's probably when it got foreclosed on, because that was just back here in June. Or it could have been from before. We can check on that, too. Because this was originally sold for $350 in 2008, which was probably a pretty good deal, because at one time they had it listed, too, at $380. So in this last period of time since 2005, and so let's go ahead and go look at the county records on this. It hasn't changed to who owns it yet for the recording, but it's kind of fun to see this. But this is what's interesting, too, is it has the sales history. So it was built, and then transfers. B6 LP, who knows if that's part of Gary Brown, might be because it's been in there before. And the mortgage history was 332.5. But let's take a look at something, what it's taxed at. It's taxed at $342. So the county has it higher. And so it's, if you like something unique, this is a great property for it. One of the weird things about this, and probably one of the biggest turnoffs, is the size of the bedroom. It's 15 by 9. 9 feet long is hardly enough to put in your bed and walk on the end of it if you have a sleigh bed or something like that. It has to be just a sleek line so that you don't have any issues with getting around it. Longworth Road is the most expensive one today, and that's only $314,900. And this one's kind of interesting. It's on 1.32 acres. It has some character to it that these other houses don't have. And so I forgot to check to see what's taxed at. Okay, so here attached to the house, we have a two-car garage. This is kind of interesting the way they have a garbage bin right there tucked away. Now, in the MLS sheet, it says the floor covering in the kitchen is tile. To me, it looks like carpet, and when you put it up against the wall, the cabinets like that, it definitely should be carpet. So you're going to have to confirm that. I wanted to double-check to see if this was electric baseboard heat or hot water baseboard heat. And I'm thinking it's electric, but once again, you have to confirm because you're never sure, especially when it comes to bank-owned properties. Those still kind of do look like electric. Now, this room kind of entices me because it looks like it's a sunroom, and I can't tell what's out there. It just feels like that, so that must be on the south side to generate more heat in it, the house, and then there might be curtains. But on the outside, I don't see any pictures, and that's the best picture I think we have of this place. Interesting also to have the hot water heater in the garage. I think that's not the best place for a hot water heater, but that also tells us that there is no basement. So I don't see that little sunroom I was looking for, but isn't that acreage nice? So if you want to have space, you have it. And here's an RV garage, and it's a detached garage. So see, that's how you know you have that. Oh, and there's that little sunroom. Okay, finally a picture with it. So anyway, they use the full 25 photos, which is pretty cool to have that done. Now, I want to show you something else here, and let's see if I can do this without... This is one of the tools I use to analyze properties for investments. And one of the things that it's kind of hard to get your head around sometimes is what should you... excuse me while I move things around here. What should you have it? Are you better off for going properties at 200, 250, 180? You know, what should we be looking at? So I did one here. This was at 200, and we're going to take this and move it over to this other side. We're going to do a little bit different example. So we have 200 on the right-hand side. We're going to go ahead and put in 170 on this side. Now, it's a little bit harder to find a property at 170, and so we have this here. So now on the right-hand side, and I think if I can light, oops. That's not what I meant to do. I'm just going to go ahead and get rid of that. If I can do this right and line it up right, then what you'll be able to see is what happens to the right. Now, once again, this is 200. So the numbers will be a little bit different. So on 200, you put 50,000 down. At 25%, you put 370,000 down. Closing cost, you know, you have insurance to pay. You have taxes to pay. You have all little kinds of things to pay on there, so might as well go ahead and put that down. Now, part of the key is here, so we have our property value at 170, and that stays pretty consistent at this time. Now, mortgage rates are pretty amazing, and you might be able to get a mortgage at 5%, which is awesome, but this is cash flow before tax, and we haven't put any taxes in yet. I'm going to go ahead and raise this up a little bit more. And move this over so that you can kind of see a little, there we go, we'll be good here. So you can see the numbers here, you can see the graphs here. All right, so what's our appreciation rate? Well, really, I think it should be 5%. I put 3% on the other side. So let's start with 5%, and then I'll adjust it to 3%. So 5%, here in 2005, our property value has gone up to 336,588. And our mortgage is now down to 90. But let's be conservative and take it down to 3%. And here in 2005, our property value is worth 257 and our mortgage is 90. So even at 3%, we're making values. It's not just straight across. Okay, gross annual income. I had it 16,000 for a little bit larger property. But let's go ahead and make it 13. just because it's kind of hard. And yeah, 13. I was going to do $1,300 a month, which to me, see, rents are going up, and it's really kind of confusing. So at $1,300 a month, it's 5%. You should always do a vacancy rate, even though it's not much. Our effective gross income now, operating expenses. Okay, so what do we put in for here? And let's go ahead and take a look at our operating expenses on this side. Yeah, and then we can kind of take and compare. So we're going to go down to 1,400. Well, we should actually go down to 13 or less. Insurance, I'm still going to put in at 500. I found out that Windsor Windsor and Milliken both have higher insurance because of high hail damage and other things. So maintenance, I believe, is $100 a month. It's, you know, you could analyze it without, and if that's okay, if you want to do it that way. Commissions, we really don't have that. Utilities in our area, unless you have something unique that you want to pay utilities for, typically the tenant pays. And others, I leave commission in. And that would be, what have I done? Property taxes, oh yeah, $1,560. So just to keep things simple, I do it as 10% of the annual income. So we'll save that, and that's changed our little graph here a little bit, so our cash flow is a little bit less. And we're going to go ahead and save that again, so that goes away. All right, back to this graph now. So we have so far, our net operating income is $11,032. Our cap rate at this point is 6.48. Annual rent increase. I put 7% on the other side because our rates seem to be jumping up quite a bit. So let's look to see what happens to the graph when I do that. Oh, wow. Look how it keeps going up. Okay. So now, if income's going up, expenses have to go up. Yeah? So, all right. Well, let's let it go up. Oh, and I put 4% on the other side, so let's do it that way too. So now we have a 30-year mortgage. We have an annual mortgage payment of $8,124. We have a cash flow of $3,000, about $2,908. And our cash-on-cash return is 6.22. Now, what's important about the cash-on-cash return? And then I really do believe in taking out mortgage for investment properties, because of the cash on cash. Just for fun, if you did this with a purchase price and your down payment is 170, so basically you have no loan, well, look how it changes things. Whoa, this is interesting. Your cash on cash return is 6.37, so maybe I'm speaking wrong. All right, so cash on cash return or not, it's a great place to invest in property. And what are the banks paying you on interest today? I think this is a much better place to put your money. So if I can grab this here. This is Nanci Garnand with RE/MAX Alliance. It's the Garnand Group. And the best way to contact us is either by email, and I'm getting a software update check, or by phone at 970-622-1810. Have a great day, and we look forward to talking to you on Monday when we cover the new listings in Loveland.